Hi, and welcome back to PGTV, the Podesta Group's online video discussion series featured on our blog, The PG Pipeline. I'm Katie Beck, and today we're going global. I'm here with two of my colleagues from the firm's international sector, former Assistant Secretary of State under President George W. Bush, and a Governor Romney foreign policy advisor, Stephen Rademaker. I'm also here with former National Security Council Director under President Clinton, Mark Tavlarides. Welcome, guys, and thanks so much for joining us. I want to start off by talking about what's going on in the news, and that is that we have an election impending here in the United States, here at home, and whether we have a new administration in a month or a second Obama administration, what we know for sure is there are going to be a lot of changes. So walk us through some of these potential changes and the implications of them for your clients abroad as it relates to policy and politics.
Well, if there is a second Obama administration, you will certainly have new leadership at the Department of State. Secretary Clinton has announced that she will end her term of service at the end of this administration. So you will not only see a new Secretary of State, but many senior advisors that currently work for the Secretary will be leaving. So you'll have a new foreign policy team, largely the Department of State. Some people think that it could be John Kerry, the current chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. Others think it could be Susan Rice, the current U.S. ambassador to the United Nations. But nevertheless, you are going to see changes to the department. And while the president sets policy, he certainly relies on his senior advisors for advice on developing foreign policy initiatives and carrying them out. So with a new team, you're likely to see some new initiatives in foreign policy. In terms of the NSC, I don't know whether you'll see some changes there. That's a very good team over there, and there haven't been any reports of possible changes at the NSC. Possible changes to the Department of Defense should Secretary Panetta determine that after this term that he no longer wishes to serve. And there are some names that have been bandied about, but there's not a lot of discussion at this point whether there'll be some changes at DOD.
Obviously, if Governor Romney is elected president, there will be major changes in personnel as well as changes in policy. At this point, there's a lot of speculation about who the new senior officials might be in a Romney administration. For the State Department, Bob Zoellick, the former president of the World Bank, former deputy secretary of state, is one rumored contender for that position. Bob Kimmitt, the former deputy secretary of the Treasury, is another. Other names have been suggested, but typically for that position, someone has to come in with fairly serious experience at either the cabinet level or immediate sub-cabinet level in another agency. So it will probably be a known quantity to become Secretary of State. At the Defense Department, former Senator Jim Talent, who's a very senior advisor to the Romney campaign, seems to be the favorite, and it's pretty clear he's interested in that position. And is taking a lot of interest in defense issues. And then there'll be the question of the White House staff and the National Security Council. And there are many candidates who have been discussed. But then below all of these people, there'll be enormous changeover. All the political appointees from the Obama administration will be out, and new political appointees will come in.
And I imagine there won't just be new faces in the administration. With the election and a slew of member retirements going on potentially happening on Capitol Hill, what changes should clients prepare for in Congress? And what sort of strategic advice will you be offering our international clients for advancing their own interests in a new Congress?
There will definitely be changes there'll be, due to retirements, significant changes in the makeup of Congress. But whether the House or Senate are run by Democrats or Republicans, you will see changes in the leadership of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and the House Foreign Affairs Committee, two key clients for international clients. On the Democratic side, Chairman Kerry could become Secretary of State, which could open up the chairmanship or the ranking Democratic position to Senator Menendez. On the Republican side, Senator Lugar lost his reelection, and it's expected that Senator Bob Corker from Tennessee could be the chief Republican member on that committee. On the House Foreign Affairs Committee, due to term limits, Chairman Ileana Ross-Layton will end her term of service as chairman. There are two members that are widely believed to be vying for the chairmanship or top Republican spot on that committee: Chris Smith from New Jersey, longtime member of the committee, and Ed Royce from California, also a longtime member of the committee. On the Democratic side, the current ranking member is Howard Berman. Howard Berman is in a reelection campaign with another senior member on that committee, Brad Sherman. So if Howard Berman is reelected, I expect him to continue in the top spot for the Democrats. If he loses, you could see either Brad Sherman taking over the top Democratic spot or possibly even Elliot Engel of New York. So there will be changes there. And for clients, it's very important early on to position themselves with the new leadership of those committees as they develop their agendas for the next Congress and to work with what will certainly be new staff running those committees.
Steve, you want to touch on the Republican side of things?
Well, I think Mark has covered the Republican side pretty well. I do think the point he last made about new staff is critically important. When a new member comes in as either chairman or ranking, frequently they almost always make some staff changes. Sometimes they change the entire staff. And that actually has enormous practical implications because the staff of these committees is highly professional. They have great expertise in their respective areas. And they have a great deal of influence over the executive branch because they develop relationships with counterparts in the executive branch. And typically, the chairman and ranking members of these committees listen very carefully to the advice that they receive from these expert staff members. And developing relationships with them, educating them about issues of concern to our clients would be a top priority for us in the new year.
And I know there are almost 200 countries in the world. And presumably most of them want to promote their own foreign policy agendas, making for a very competitive environment here in Washington. So what are some of the keys to success for grabbing policymakers' attention and making sure your client's priorities are front and center?
I think for us, the most important element of that is what we call messaging. It's knowing enough about the interests and predilections of the individual members and their staff to know what messages, what arguments will resonate with them, and advising our clients on what to say, how to package their concern or their request, whatever the issue is, and then also advising them strategically on who it is they need to talk to, because you know oftentimes it's just a handful of members or a handful of staff who are the critical players on a particular issue. And that's something that's often not evident to people who've not worked in the process or with the process for many years.
Yeah, I would also add, you mentioned there are almost 200 countries in the world pursuing a foreign policy agenda. So in terms of working with Congress, which plays a role in terms of foreign assistance, setting policy guidelines for foreign policy, there are challenges to outreach to Congress. You have members that have very demanding schedules. They have their schedules with their constituents, their voting schedule, their committee responsibilities. And so it is very difficult many times for embassies to establish relationships with these members of Congress just by virtue of the time constraints. So we are in a very good position to develop relationships for those embassies with key policymakers in Congress. By virtue of our relationships over the years that we've developed from a professional standpoint. And Steve mentioned messaging. We have found that it's very useful in working with Congress to make a case why it's in the U.S. interest for a member of Congress to engage an embassy in a foreign country. If a member believes there's a sound argument for developing a relationship with this country from an American interest standpoint and an interest that serves both countries, we think it puts an embassy in a very good position.
So whether it's, you know, your client's goal is to shape policy or legislation, generate goodwill, secure foreign aid, or even mitigate a crisis, what are some of the biggest challenges that face the global community here in Washington for changing perceptions or even just breaking through and having that message you just talked about being heard?
I think these days one of the biggest challenges is the fact that our nation continues to be in an economic crisis, and politicians, Republicans and Democrats in the Congress, in the executive branch, their number one priority is fixing the American economy. And so foreign policy oftentimes is seen as a distraction from what these individuals believe they were elected to focus on. And as Mark indicated, explaining to them the national interest that is at stake is often a key part of our mission on behalf of clients. Typically, we're hired by either countries or companies that have a problem that they want America's help to fix it, or they may have a specific issue they want. There are countries that are traditionally foreign aid recipients, and they'd like to keep the foreign aid coming. In the current environment, that can be a challenge because we're increasingly in a resource-constrained environment. So putting all of these things in the national security context and helping educate members of Congress and incoming administration officials who may not be familiar with these issues is going to be an important part of our work at the start of 2013.
Excellent. Mark, do you want to add anything?
Well, in to just build on Steve's comments, you know, whether there's going to be an Obama administration or a Romney administration, we are going to engage countries throughout the globe that are neither our friends or our enemies. There are many times somewhere in between. There will be times where these countries will work with us out of shared interests. Countries act out of shared interests. And there are other times they will disagree with us. That happens all the time. There's a tendency on the part of some policymakers to kind of put members in countries in categories of friends or enemies. So part of our effort is to explain where there are common interests that we can develop with these countries that we should pursue without necessarily putting them in a box that could put them in a disadvantage in their dealing with Congress.
Excellent. Well, thank you both very much. Very insightful. And for further insight and analysis on international and other pressing policy issues moving forward, keep your eyes on the PG pipeline.